Right. We're coming back for a part two. I answered a bunch of questions in a part one, all of these farm questions, and there's so many. There's so many. You guys asked so many good questions, and I just couldn't bring myself to not get to more of them, but that video I think will probably end up being like an hour long. So this is part two. If you missed part one, I will link it down below in the description box so you can go check that out. I also will link our farm Instagram account down there, as well as my personal Instagram account if you'd like to follow me, or you can follow the farm account, or both, or whatever tickles your fancy. Now my battery wants to die. I'm glad I brought another one with me. Let me see if I can race to beat the battery to tell you that if you're new here, my name's Angela. I'm a mom of eight. My husband and I bought this farm last year, and we've just been, just diving in head first, making it our own. And yeah, so we're answering farm questions. Let me change my battery and I'll be right back. How difficult was the raised garden beds? So I did a video, I will link that as well down below, sharing how I created my raised bed garden. On a difficult scale, not difficult, but time consuming and a lot of manual labor, yes. I always try to make it clear with these projects that I'm not an expert. I'm learning as I go, I'm trying things, I'm figuring things out. I'm not somebody who kind of sits on my hands until I have it all perfect. I usually just dive in and figure it out as I go. So same thing with the raised beds. Obviously, like, the most amount of work was tearing what was already there in existence out. That was a lot. I'd actually had the intention of doing two separate sections, but when I saw, like, when I figured out how much work it was for that one section, I was like, nope, I'm just gonna make this one section bigger and I'm not gonna worry about that other one right now because I just need to get this going. Like, I need to get these seeds in the ground, I need to get these plants growing, and this is very, very time consuming. So I also think that with any project, one thing we've learned is that having the right tools makes everything go smoother. This is not an advertisement for any tool brand or anything. I'm just saying, having the right tools always makes projects easier. Some of your animals seem like they're more free to roam around. Are you afraid of them running away? So I know sometimes you'll see in videos like the pig's out, the goats are out, different things. A lot of times my daughter will come out and she will let some of the barnyard animals out to graze and just kind of chill around the property. And she'll either watch them from her window or sit outside and hang out with them. And again, this place is kind of bustling all the time. We're always kind of in and out doing things and different, you know, my husband and I, my parents, whatever, we're always kind of back and forth. So the animals are supervised. But thus far, we've not had anybody try to escape. You know, the goat, Lottie, doesn't even really, I mean, she'll follow you down the driveway if you're going down to like feed a horse or something, but she doesn't go down there on her own. She stays kind of up. So the pigs will follow their nose. So we don't, like, you have to check on them every 20 minutes or so. But again, they've never like gone to the road or anything. They just kind of start to whittle down the driveway a little bit. But yeah, I mean, they're following their nose. How do you get your Sabbath and how is that different with all of your responsibilities? It is much, much harder because of me. Like, it's not anything else other than my incessant need to feel like I am utilizing my time as best as possible. Number one, I don't like to be lazy. And number two, I don't like to feel like I'm being lazy. And I don't like to feel like I'm wasting time. Time is the most precious thing that I have. It's the thing I can't create any more of. I can't do anything to change the amount of time. And so I never like to feel like I'm wasting my time. I have had to do a little bit of like heart work on myself and understanding the importance of Sabbath and the importance of rest, and not working yourself to the bone. That time of rest is vitally important, and not to brush it off and fill that time with other things just because I can. So that's more of like a heart issue. I wouldn't say that there's the amount of work here doesn't allow me to have a Sabbath, other than to understand that there's never a day where we don't have to do something. Obviously the animals have to be fed every day. The chickens and ducks have to be cleaned every day. They don't care if it's Sunday, whatever day it is, that stuff has to be done. So there's never a day where there's truly no work happening, but there's a massive difference between waking up and like hitting, going and project, here we go, we're doing this, and taking care of the responsibilities, but resting in between. How are the farm chores split between you, your parents, and the kids? It kind of looks different a little bit just depending on what's going on. Our oldest two typically feed barnyard animals. That's something that we pay them for. We don't typically pay our kids for chores. They have specific chores, but the barnyard is a job that they have that we pay for. And the girls also get paid to feed the horses, although right now my parents are coming out and doing that because they have a sick horse who needs a medication, and they have to really keep a very close eye on her. And so if they're out here twice a day anyways, then they just feed the horses. We all check waters throughout the day. I take care of, you know, the garden and watering things and stuff like that. Christopher does the trash. He makes sure that all the trash gets taken out. I mean, we all kind of have things like that that are our responsibilities, but we also jump in and help each other and, you know, sort of shift things around if we need to, or, you know, whatever the case may be. So we all work together, but yeah, we do kind of in some ways have that stuff split up. Like my parents take care of seeding the pastures and stuff. So my dad comes over and hooks up the tractor, ATV, or whatever needs to be done, and drives around and seeds pastures. My mom mows the lawn. A lot of times she likes driving the zero turn lawnmower, and neither Christopher or I have gotten a lesson on how to drive that yet. So they come out and do the zero turn mower to mow the grass around the property and down the driveway and out front and all of that. So everybody's contributing. It's all hands on deck. And we all just kind of do what makes sense for us to do, or what we're good at, or what time constraints make possible, that sort of thing. Well, Bodie and Oliver act as herders. Those are my daughter's two toy Australian Shepherd puppies. That's not what they're here for. I'm sure their instincts will kick in and they'll try, but that's not, those are my daughter's dogs, like, you know, as they claim that they're going to be taking them with them when they move out. We'll see about that. I said the same thing about my dachshund, and then he ended up becoming best friends with my mom's dog and never left again. So we understand that they may not, but they may also. So the girls really want to do agility with them, agility courses or dock diving. Kennedy's really interested in doing dock diving with Bodie. I've had a few people ask some questions, and so I was going to talk to the girls about seeing if they'd be open to doing a Q&A about their pets and their plans for their pets and training and all that. If you've seen any of our vlogs, my girls are have done an excellent job training their puppies. I'm honestly shocked at the number of tricks and commands and things like that that they've learned from a super, you know, young age. They're very diligent in taking care of their pets. So they're fantastic pet owners, let's say that. Why do we get animals from a breeder? Lots of questions about why don't we get all of our animals from rescues or shelters? Why do we buy from certain breeders and stuff? Again, this is where I'm gonna come back to like the do we eat meat and have pet kind of a thing. Like, I understand the heart behind the question. What I will say is there's so many factors that go into adding a new animal. And I think that it's a little naive to think that every animal we add could be a rescue. Given our situation with having our 8 children, as well as the purpose for what we hope to do long term with some of the animals and the farm, I suppose I could try to sit here and go through each animal and explain why we chose to go the route that we did. But I think that would be a waste of your time and mine. So just, you know, I would say like a blanket answer to that would be that we consider all options when adding an animal, and we consider what makes the most sense for the farm as a whole, what makes the most sense for our family, what makes the most sense for the future plans. We have every pet we've ever had prior to moving here has been from a shelter or a rescue. I can't think of any pet we've had since Christopher and I got married that wasn't from a shelter or a rescue. Every cat, every dog, all of that. So it's not that we are people that don't care at all, or don't put any consideration into that. And I would hope that if you've been around here long enough to know that I am thoughtful in that, and that we have reasons for why we choose to do things the way that we do. Yeah, so I'm not saying that there won't ever be any animals that we add. Like I said, half of my parents' horses are rescue horses that were discarded as foals and other situations that weren't working out for them. So half or more of my parents' horses are rescues. So yeah, we're not opposed to rescue situations or, you know, getting animals from shelters for certain things, but in some situations it's not the right answer. So we use our discernment and discretion in making those decisions on an individual basis. Are we gonna cut or shave the llamas? This is something that I, in doing my research, have learned is a little bit like people feel very strongly one way or the other about whether you should or shouldn't. So I am still trying to do more research into understanding that, particularly before it gets too hot here, because my instinct is to like, yes, do it. But then at the same time, there's some really good arguments to be made for not doing it. So I'm still doing my research on that to figure out if we will or not. Though, what if we do, it will be a rodeo, because just trimming their nails is a rodeo. What's the best way to learn about owning equine if you have no experience? I would look for a horse farm around you and ask to visit, ask to volunteer. Specifically, ask to volunteer, because just can I come take up some of your time is, you know, for somebody that's waking up early and feeding and doing all these chores and stuff, you know, that's kind of a big ask. So maybe ask if you can come volunteer. When I was interested in learning about the llamas, I called her up and said, hey, can my daughters and I come up and help with afternoon chores or do something like that? Like, we would love to understand the care for llamas, like not just come see them, but like, let me see if this is something I actually think we can do. And that's best done by, you know, putting your boots on and going out there and doing it. So that's what we did. And so I would recommend that, asking if there's a way that you can volunteer. Horses in particular, I have actually been very hesitant to ever own any horses myself that lived on my property that I was responsible for ultimately, because they are large animals. They are curious animals that get themselves into a lot of trouble. They can have a lot of injuries and sicknesses, and it's just, they're a little fickle to care for. Horses are a little fickle. They're not nearly as hardy as you think that they would be given just their sheer size. So horses are one that I would say, I would be very reticent to say, like, jump in. I would say, really stop, wait, do your research a ton before you get horses, because they are very expensive to care for as well. Not some of the other animals, their expenses are pretty low, but horses, depending on the situation and the horse and all of that, I mean, care in and of itself can be very expensive. Do all of your kids help with farm work, or just the older two? No, they all help. The other kids, the middles and the littles, as we kind of break them up, don't have any like designated, this is your one job. They typically help us with jobs because I'm not quite ready to release the responsibility. Like, I don't worry that my older two are gonna forget to feed the animals. So if I have to go behind them to check anyways, until I'm certain that I can trust you, I would rather just have you help. And so that's kind of where we're at right now. They're definitely getting to the age where we can start to release some things to them. But for right now, they're just kind of helping with whatever's going on, not owning any one chore or responsibility. Do you feed your animals any specific foods, vitamins, etc., or just regular what they are supposed to eat? So this is why I say, like, homesteading, owning these animals can be done more affordably probably than we do it in a lot of ways, because again, my daughters are very research driven, and so one of the things that means is that we end up doing a lot of different supplements and things like that for different animals, and feeding, we definitely feed top of the line food to most of our animals in some capacity or another, and so it can get expensive, but we try to do our research into what's necessary, what's needed, what's beneficial. Again, you know, just everything is different, right? If you've got goats that you're gonna use for milk, and so they're pregnant or they're gonna be in milk, you know, soon or whatever, like the type of food and stuff that you would wanna give them would look different than a goat that's just chilling, you know, and not doing anything, not growing another goat or feeding another goat or producing milk and that sort of thing. So the diets all look a little bit different. I mean, we start with the baseline, but everybody gets added supplements and stuff like that. So, I mean, our dogs get raw dog food now, and it's expensive. It's really expensive. And yeah, I mean, I'm not gonna lie, it's expensive, but we've seen such a huge improvement, particularly in our older dog, Stella, that it's like we can't go back now. Like, she's almost like gotten 5 years added to her life. I don't know how much longer she'll live, but I just mean she's like, she just, her whole personality, her skin, her coat, everything has improved so much since switching her to this raw food diet. So yeah, it's definitely pricey, but worth it if we can. You know, if we can afford to do it, then we will keep doing it to give our animals the best food that we possibly can. What breeds of chickens did you get? So we have Golden Comets, Midnight Majestic Marins, and then we have some Easter Eggers. So they're kind of like mixed breeds, but they lay the colorful Easter eggs. What's the funniest thing you've seen on the farm? Oh my gosh, I don't know. All the different animals do funny things at different times. I mean, this goat, Lottie, she's hilarious. It can be very annoying, but she is hilarious. And for example, yesterday I was in here working, I was sitting at my desk right here, and she just jumped through the open window. I'm like, what are you doing? I love it when she climbs up on the dirt piles and jumps and spins and acts a fool. The llamas, when they pronk and they run, it's like a skipping thing that they do. The horses chase each other and they do like their little and show their teeth and stuff. I mean, all of the animals kind of have their moments of doing funny things. So yeah, they're fun. Any animals your kids want but you don't? Oh yes, lots. The boys specifically would like some reptiles. The reptiles. Now, I'm not opposed to like a gecko or something like that. I really love the chameleons. But it's going to be a while for anything like that, years, until I can really trust that they're going to take care of it. Because again, I am like those indoor little pets like that, that don't make a lot of noise and you don't hardly know are there, are actually harder for me to care for. The other ones, it's like, I'm out, they're out. I see them, I know to feed them, I don't forget. I'm afraid I would forget to take care of something that was inside in a cage. They would love to have a guinea pig, for example, but I am allergic to guinea pigs, so no guinea pigs, things like that, but nothing like crazy. You know, I've got lots of questions about how much food do we go through in a week with the animals, bedding, hay, all of that. I would really need to sit down and try to break that up, because obviously, like hay bales, you know, we're sharing that cost with my parents. They have hay for the horses, and then we use hay for the llamas and goats and stuff. Right now, I'm using 3 or 4 bags of pine bedding a week for the ducks and the chickens, because I just have to replace it basically completely every day now, because they're all so big and they poop so much. It's kind of just depends, like, seasonally, how much they're using certain things. But I do have like a budget tracker thing. I just need to sit down and kind of like map it all out. Maybe if I can, if I remember, I will try to do a rough estimate and put it here on the screen of maybe like monthly cost for all the animals, for their food, for their hay, and any like monthly supplements or anything like that that they get. The total cost a month for all of that for our animals. I'll have to retract the horses out of that, because that's not something we pay for. So if I remember to do that, I'll put it here on the screen. Which farm animals are the easiest to take care of with little kids? Both my kids are under 3. I cut off the rest of, we're hoping to start our own mini farm soon. I mean, really, animals that stay in an enclosure, like the goats, if they stay in the enclosure, then you have goats like Lottie who leave it every day. But chickens are, I think, super popular. Backyard chickens are something that I think are very, very beneficial. You take care of them, they take care of you. You know, you feed them, you give them lots of good healthy food, and they give you good healthy eggs. It's a pretty fair trade-off. They don't have some crazy long lifespan that you're gonna have a 50-year-old chicken or something like that. So, and a lot of places will allow you to have chickens in your backyard. So backyard chickens, I think, are probably would be probably the easiest. Definitely, I mean, like the llamas and the horses, that's like, I would consider that more like advanced. I don't think your kids are gonna get a ton out of that, and they are more work. It is harder to find a vet that knows how to take care of llamas, and you do need a llama specific vet. So those would be, I would say, like the hardest in terms of that element of the expense and the care and all of that. But goats are great. I always say, like, I think having goats can be kind of like having dogs. And especially if you get ones that are polled, which means they naturally don't have any horns, or you have them disbudded in, they can be really great with kids and super fun and funny and curious. And they're really fun animals to have. The horns can be a little iffy though, just depending on the goats. How are the bunnies? I might have missed it in the video. I just don't hear about them anymore. Lots of questions about the bunnies. They're great. They are free ranging bunnies. So they live upstairs in my daughter's room, like free roaming. So, you know, the door is open all the time and they don't ever come out. Like, they stay in there. That's where they want to stay. The girls have the biggest room in the house, basically. So they free roam up there, and the girls bring them down usually because of all the hullabaloo during the day, and bunnies like to sleep during the day and they're up at night. So that's mostly why you don't see them in videos, is that they're just not usually up during the day when we're doing stuff. And so a lot of times in the evening after dinner, when we go in like the playrooms, that area to watch a movie, the girls will put up the little baby gate and they'll bring the bunnies down and they'll run around downstairs and hang out. But they are a lot bigger. So like when they were smaller, it was easier just to bring them downstairs for a little bit, but they're a lot bigger now. And so it's like, bring them downstairs, bring their litter box down, like all of that stuff is a lot. So they chill upstairs and then they come downstairs usually in the evening to watch a movie. So it is tough, you know, because I feel like sometimes, and this is something that we've always, like, it's always been something that's frustrated my husband and I a little bit. And I'm not saying to this person who asked this question that this is what you are saying or meaning. In no way, this doesn't have anything to do with this person. But ever since, you know, we started making videos and sharing family stuff or whatever, people have a tendency to equate screen time with love. You love this child more because they see them more on video, or you don't love this child, or you don't care about this child because we don't see them much in video. And I noticed the same thing with the animals too. If certain animals don't appear in photos or videos super often, people will make assumptions about whether or not we care about that animal anymore or something like that. And it's kind of amusing to me, simply because, again, I've said this before and I'll just continue to say it in case maybe you're new and you've never heard me say this before, but we don't script our content. I don't sit down and plan out what I'm gonna film that day, what I'm gonna post as far as a picture goes or anything like that. That's just not how I live my life. And so, this is about farm stuff, so I'm not gonna talk about the kids, but if I'm around you and something funny is happening and I take your picture, or I'm around you and I'm filming at that moment, you'll be in the video. It speaks nothing to the hierarchy of love I have in my heart for any of the animals or the care or anything like that. It's just who happens to be around at that moment when I've got my phone out and I'm taking a picture, or we've got the vlogging camera out and we're filming something. So maybe it would make me a better business person to consider that I make sure that I rotate everything through so that everyone's seeing everything in equal amount of time. But I just don't have the energy for that. I don't have the brain space for that at all. I'm just gonna keep reminding people that screen time does not equal love in any capacity, in any way, shape, or form, whether it's for our kids or for our animals. And so just because you don't see them, you know, it super often, doesn't mean that they're not a part of our daily life, especially considering it's such a small portion of our life that we share online that actually comes out, you know, through Instagram or YouTube or whatever. So, and again, that was not in any way directed at the person who asked that question. Let me just be clear. How long does it take to feed and clean all the animals and their living conditions? It takes me about an hour in the morning to do the full gamut of chicken and duck stuff. Now, that's because I let the ducks have a bath every morning while I'm cleaning out their brooder. They have their bath time and play time. Then I clean out their brooder, I clean out the chickens, then I kind of have to clean up after myself doing that. And so I'm sweeping and mopping and sanitizing the floor every day. I'm also cleaning and sanitizing my tub every morning as well after the ducks swim in it. I've had some people say like, ew, I would never be able to get in that tub again if I knew the ducks were in there. And it kind of makes me laugh because I'm like, have you ever been in a lake? Do you go in the ocean? Like, do you have any idea how much, like even if you ever go in a public pool, there's human urine in there and you're swallowing it because it gets in your mouth and your eyes, like the disgusting things that are in pools and stuff. But I sanitize my tub, so I'm not somebody who gets easily grossed out by that kind of stuff either. I totally get it if you are, I'm just not. So that takes about an hour, and it takes about 10 minutes to feed the barnyard animals and about another 10 minutes to feed the horses. But if you're talking about cleaning things out, it takes a few hours to clean out the barnyard, barn area, the stalls for the goats and stuff. That's usually like a weekend thing, clean everything out. I can't speak to the chicken coop and run yet, the outdoor one, because that's not done. So I don't know how much time that will take, but I would say all in all, we probably spend about 2 hours a day. Chicken coops, better to buy plans and build one or buy a ready-made one? It depends on your time constraints, your budget, and kind of what you want for it. So we looked into so many different options, and because we had just spent so much time building this office, neither one of us really had it in us to build a structure ourselves from the ground up, though lots of people do. Again, tons of plans on Pinterest that are free. And then also even like on Etsy and stuff, there's lots of people who for relatively cheap, $5 or you know something like that, will sell plans of how to build things yourself. So there's so many different options that are really, really affordable when it comes to like chicken coops and enclosures and stuff like that. So it really depends on your situation, I would say, which one is better. Do all the animals in the barnyard get along? Do you think y'all will need to separate any? They do get along. There's little squabbles here and there, but nobody's like going for the gusto. Nobody's trying to kill each other or you know, really seriously harm or maim each other. Sometimes the goats will bully the pigs a little bit. They'll try to headbutt them. The reality is that the pigs could easily wallop back on them. I mean, those pigs are sturdy. They could beat the tar out of those goats if they wanted to, throw those fat little bodies around, but they usually just walk away. So it's not like intense or anything like that. But yeah, I mean, there's a little bit of that there, but the llamas are kind of the overseers of everybody. And the goats are just goats. They play and have fun. Sometimes they get a little rough with the pigs, but, you know, it's not usually, there's nothing like actually like harmful happening. They're just kind of like, you know, bothering each other. What homestead channels have you been following for inspiration on the farm? Like I said, I think I talked about in the other video, Justin Rhodes, Roots and Refuge, I really like. I follow a lot of Instagram accounts as well. As far as like videos I watch, those are kind of the main ones. I also really like watching Weed 'Em and Reap. When I have time, let me just preface this with like, I don't watch a lot of videos. So it's like very sporadic or something specific I'm looking for. So especially with goat related things, I look to Weed 'Em and Reap for that kind of information. But really, I mean, all of those channels, you know, provide information on those things. So I love Jessica from Roots and Refuge, just because I feel like her heart matches mine, and you know, she's great to listen to, and her videos are like just super chill and calming, and I could listen to her voice all day long. And Justin Rhodes, I feel like I go to for like really very practical things. And again, I've learned a lot from them and their channel about caring for these animals, being a good steward of what you've been given, loving them, respecting them, and what that looks like. And then I think Weed 'Em and Reap is so fun to see. I think it's incredible to see how they have this 1 acre plot of land and everything they've been able to do on 1 acre. It reminds me when I feel like, oh, we don't have enough land. I wish we had more land. I wish we would have bought more land. Like I have those moments where I feel like I could do this if I had more land. Watching their channel always reminds me what's possible on, you know, you don't have to have 25 acres to be able to do certain things. So I really find that very inspiring from their channel specifically as well. What's it like to have 8 kids in a mini farm? Can it be stressful? Lots of questions about time management and stuff like that. You know, there's a couple of things I would say. I would say that when you look at things through the lens of this is what I want, I'm doing this because I want this, this is what I want for my family, this is the life I want to cultivate. When we reframe how we look at the chores and the work and everything, it does change our attitudes. And when we change our attitudes, we can in turn, in many ways, become more productive in those areas and more efficient with our time. I also think that having a farm, doing these projects, all of this, it's like a muscle that you exercise. And the more that you exercise it, the easier it becomes. And it's hard to explain other than to say that I know that for some people from the outside looking in, it can seem very overwhelming or like, I mean, people say it to me all the time, like, why are you doing this so quickly? You've bit off more than you can chew. Why did you do this? Why did you do that? You should, all of that stuff. And everyone's entitled to their own opinions, right? I mean, as my mother used to say, opinions are like, you know what holes, and everybody's got them and they all stink. So I am fully aware that everyone has their own opinion, but I'm the one living my life. I'm the one here every day. I'm the one that knows what it looks like. And for our family as a whole, and for my husband and I, we become more efficient at certain things so that they become a little easier. And then as you're adding more things, it's just not quite the same. I don't really know how to explain it other than that. It's a muscle that you're using and you're becoming stronger in it. You're becoming more efficient in it. And it's something that we really enjoy. And I think the last thing that I would say to that is something that I have spoken about before in relation to motherhood, but I think it applies here too, is that we as a society have a major problem with seeing any type of difficulty or adversity or hardship or something that's challenging as problematic or as something we should avoid at all costs. And I have just found that I think like many of you and like most people, that the best things in life are the hard things. They're not the easy things. They are the hard things. And so I don't shy away from the hard things. I don't look at something and go, well, that's too much. That's too much work. That's, you know, I don't want to do that. It's not how I choose to view these things. I choose to view them through the lens of character shaping and the way that it's educating me, the things that I'm learning, the skills that I'm learning, and then extrapolate that out to my kids, the things that they're learning, the skills that they're learning. You know, we always say hard isn't always bad and good isn't always easy. And that's just, I mean, that just pretty much well sums it up. I've never claimed that my life is easy or simple or any of those things, which I think is sometimes why there's this like this contention I feel sometimes when it maybe seems like I'm getting defensive when people are like, wow, you make it look so easy. I don't think I make it look easy. I think I just don't complain constantly about the workload that I have or the things that I have to do, because to me, these are things that I've chosen. So why would I come on and complain about them? These are things that I've chosen for my life and I enjoy it. I enjoy the hard work. I enjoy being tired at the end of the day. You know, there's absolutely difficult moments and challenges along the way, but in some ways I welcome them and, you know, in other ways I struggle. But yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I feel really good about my life and the path we've chosen and the way that we do things and our kids and the work that we put in here. It is absolutely worth it to us. So I guess that, you know, that kind of like hard is in the eye of the beholder. And as we move forward and do more things, we become more efficient and we become better at it. And I just have learned to welcome the challenges and enjoy the fruits of putting in all that hard work. Well, this question kind of follows up to that. What's harder than you thought it would be and what's easier? What's harder than I thought it would be, I suppose, is the land management itself, trying to take care of the land that the animals are utilizing and the cycles and all of that. Like, that is hard in terms of just, that's just, there's a learning curve there. Keeping my house clean is harder than I thought it would be. Maybe that seems silly, but it's harder to keep my house clean with all the, you know, with all the kids coming in and out and dust and all that kind of stuff. Like, flies, that part of it is harder. I'm sure if I thought on it for a while, I could probably think of something more profound that's harder, but that's what comes to mind. And what's easier, I would say, is just the general like morning chore, evening chore stuff. It's not that it's in and of itself is easy, it's just that there's so much of it that I enjoy that it doesn't feel like work in many ways. I look forward to coming out and watering my garden and feeding animals and taking stuff down to the compost and riding around on the ATV and taking stuff here and there and giving the kids rides. And you know, like I just enjoy it. Spending time with my family and our animals and out in nature. And you know, now that I've gotten Flonase and an allergy pill, I feel fantastic. My face isn't blowing up. And I just enjoy being outside and sort of cultivating this land and this property is much more enjoyable than I even thought it would be. When you were farm shopping, what was your criteria? How did you pick where to look? I will admit that at the beginning, you know, I didn't really know. I started with a general idea of how many acres we would need based on, you know, the horses and stuff like that. And we really went back and forth about whether or not we buy a piece of land and start from scratch, or whether or not we only look at places that are already in existence and we can just kind of work on what's there. That was my inclination, was to find something that had most of the infrastructure in place so that we weren't starting from scratch. But we kind of ended up starting from scratch anyways. One big thing for me with the property was I didn't want our house to be at the road. I didn't want our house to be close to the road and the busy road, because I knew my kids were gonna be outside, and I didn't want that at all. I wanted the distance between the house and the road. And I also really wanted mature trees on the property. I didn't want just like, oh, go find a 10 acre cleared plot of land and start completely from scratch. I really liked the idea of old things in existence already. Even the home in and of itself, while I wouldn't have been opposed to a brand new build home or that kind of thing, I really enjoyed, as I started walking through homes with character, homes that were older and just had quirks and stuff like that. I kind of like that. So I looked for that, but given, if you're looking right now, given lumber prices, I would make sure that where you're looking, start with looking for a place that has good fencing already in place. And if you need a barn, that already has a barn, because those things are expensive, especially with lumber prices having gone up and with trade labor being hard to find, at least where we are, finding somebody to even do the work, if you can afford to have it done, is a whole nother game to play. So to me, I would like, you know, go through your must-haves, you know, for your house and stuff like that, and then kind of build from there. But the fencing and barns, if you need those, if you require them for what your plans are, I would definitely look at properties that at least have some of that already functionally in place. Is there a farm animal CR had to talk you down from? ADHD brains are beautiful but crazy places. Ain't that the truth? You know, like I said, there's nothing like too bizarre. I definitely was seriously considering some geese this year, and he was like, let's wait on that. But you know, nothing, I'm trying to think if there was anything, not that he talked me out of, but just that it was like, I mean, I want a cow and stuff like that, and he's just like brakes on that. For our relationship, we've said this before, like I'm the gas pedal, he's the brakes. The answer is usually, it's not like a flat no, like absolutely no. I mean, if I wanted to get an ostrich, he would say no. He hates those kind of animals. He hates ostriches specifically. So he would say no to that. But it's usually not a flat no. It's like a let's talk about it. Explain why you want this animal, what the purpose is, that kind of thing, and then we can talk about it. It's not usually just a flat out absolutely not. I mean, unless I was like, I want a monkey, I want an elephant, I want a kangaroo. He'd be like, absolutely not. Does the farm affect your attitude towards eating meat? You know, I answered this question a little bit, I feel like, in the last video as well. But so just all I'll say about that is yes and no. No, in the sense that, does it mean that we're going to become vegans because we have these farm animals? No, I've always understood that the meat I consume comes from real living animals. I've not been obtuse to that fact. But yes, in the sense that it's given me a greater respect for farmers for farming and for, but sort of the larger picture for like meat processing and all of that, and wanting to narrow that down to better sourced meat and, you know, eventually local, and then maybe even eventually after that, our own. Do you have any professional helpers to do the daily work besides your wonderful kiddos? No, it's all us. Have I ever regretted starting this hobby farm? No, I definitely struggle with seasonal depression. So there were times during the winter when everything was bare and everything was wet and timelines were all unknown of things that I was feeling frustrated, but never regret, just frustration. Lots of questions about the pigs and like what breed they are, small pigs, that sort of thing. Here's what I'll say about pigs. Don't believe any lie that someone's selling you some kind of teacup little teeny pig. We said this when we got the pigs and we were very frank and Shelby knew this and we talked about it. Like, we knew that they were gonna be, they're Potbelly and Juliana mix pigs. So they'll probably be 50 to 60 pounds. Some people still have those as indoor pigs. That's not a good situation for us, so our pigs are not indoor pigs. But I think people get bamboozled by these teacup pig photos. Even giant hogs, they all start out as these cute teeny little piglets that fit in a teacup. But give it a few weeks or a few months, you see how fast our pigs have grown. I mean, they were teeny, teeny, tiny in September, and now look at them. I mean, I do think the camera kind of makes them look bigger than they are. They are definitely fat, but they're not that big. And I think maybe I'm also used to like full size, like hog pigs and pigs that people raise for meat and stuff. And these are much smaller than that, but they're still big pigs. Land planning, as far as that goes, one thing we've learned is, you know, watching through the season to see, like, for example, down below in our driveway, we have an area that's where all of our water builds. That's where when it rains a ton, that our water builds. So we know that like that particular area would not be a good area to ever fence in and have as part of a pasture or something like that. So kind of living in the space and getting to know the land's function. I mean, obviously up here we're kind of at a flat hilltop, so we know that, but we know like our boggy areas and stuff like that. So we're kind of learning about the land as we live here and just paying close attention so that we know how to best utilize it. But that was even one of the things when I was looking at the house before we actually bought it. I came here 3 or 4 times, and every time at a different time of day, and I was taking note of where the sun was so I would know where to plant my garden, like where was going to get the most full sun during the day and things like that. So obviously that's seasonal, but you know, we saw the property in summer and now it's spring, so we're approaching a full cycle year of that. But it's good understanding to know where things are going to best thrive on the different parts of your land. How do we afford all this? I think, you know, first of all, we're very fortunate that, you know, what we do for a living provides us the financial means to be able to take care of our family and have the animals and stuff. I know lots of people that do this, again, on a shoestring, and that they utilize their animals to help sustain the whole thing in terms of selling eggs or raising certain animals for meat, and then after it's butchered, they sell that, you know, chickens or whatever it is. There's lots of ways to do all of that. So I'm not, you know, I'm no expert in that area. But I will also say too, you know, that people choose to spend their money in different ways. And so for some people, it's taking vacations, it's having really expensive, fancy cars, or, you know, just like the creme de la creme of everything. And we've chosen to, you know, invest our money into this homestead, into this property, into this little hobby farm, because that's what brings us joy. And so that's where we choose to invest our money. There's other things that we could be doing and other ways we could be spending our money. But this is what we enjoy and this is what we prioritize. Do you ever want sheep? I don't really have a desire. I've seen them. I've seen the little baby doll sheep and stuff that people have. And I do think they're cute, but I've got no desire for sheep. I don't, maybe that will change someday, but I've just got no desire for sheep. How do you, or if you do, prepare your children for the inevitable death of one of your animals? So we've actually had a few very close calls since moving here. It's something that we talk about. And like I said, we didn't know if little Poppy, our little duckling, was going to live. And so preparing them and just talking about it and talking about life and death and what that means and what that looks like. And there's been two horses that we thought we were going to lose. And my parents just lost their very old dachshund, dog Emma. So my kids are keenly aware of that. And it's just part of the conversation and part of living on a farm and just having any kind of animal or pet in general is you're likely going to outlive it. And understanding life cycles and what that means. It doesn't necessarily make it any easier on them, but I think it's something that we're able to openly discuss. How about a rooster? I don't have any intentions of having a rooster at this point, though I can't promise that none of the hens that we have will turn out to be roosters. I mean, I bought them all as pullets, but there's always a margin of error in that. So they're supposed to all be females, but I had a sneaking suspicion when they were a week or two old that one, maybe two of them was actually a cockerel, but I'm not 100% sure at this point. So time will tell. Same things with the ducks. I didn't fart, that's my foot. If I farted, I would just cut it out. But the same thing with the ducks. So female ducks are just called ducks and male ducks are called drakes. And again, we set out to have all females there, but because of the ducks we got locally, we're not sure. And again, even from the hatchery, they say like there's a chance we could be wrong. It's a small one, but they could be. So ideally, you know, I could go on a whole thing about this, but like male ducks can be very violent with female ducks, and there's the whole thing there. So the ideal ratio, I believe, is 6 to 1, 6 female ducks to 1 drake. So there's one of our ducklings that I have a suspicion is a drake. So long as it's just the one, then we should be okay with those numbers. If it's not, then, you know, at a certain age and stuff, we may have to separate or bring in, I know people who like allow their drake to be in with their ducks for a certain number of hours and then he gets separated. We may eventually have to add more female ducks to balance out because they just need to keep them in check and put them in their place. So you can research that on your own. I don't want to go there in this video, but male ducks can be a little bit crazy. My slip-on leather boots I use for chores. So I have a pair of Ariat boots and a pair of Blundstone boots. The Blundstone boots are tighter fitting. Those are my nicer ones. So I typically don't wear those when I'm doing something that's really muddy or whatever. If it's not muddy, then I'll wear them, and I'll wear those, you know, I wear them all out to the store and stuff. My Ariat boots are a little bit looser fitting. The actual like width of the sole of them, they're a little bit thicker, a little bit wider. The Blundstones, like I said, are really kind of tight fitting. I think some people do actually ride in them. I'm not sure. I haven't looked close enough at the heel to see if I could actually ride in them, but I think that might be why they're a little bit narrower. But the Ariat boots are super comfortable because I can slip them on and off, and those are like my favorite work boots. Although my mom just gave me a pair of boots that don't fit her anymore. They're like paddock boots. They're more like an English riding boot, but they're really comfortable. So I've been wearing those too. But yeah, I typically wear those boots because they allow me to go through whatever I'm doing. Sure, some people just wear slip-ons, clogs, whatever in the garden, but I need to go from the garden to doing something else in here with the horses to down to the compost. And I don't want to get bit by a snake. I don't want to get a weird bug bite or anything. Like, so I like to wear like my durable boots all the time. Financing tips for a hobby farm. Again, if you're starting from the very beginning, if you're starting from scratch, you can always do things that help pay for other things. Like I said, start your chicken flock first and sell eggs and start, you know, trying to make some money back that way. I recommend highly Justin Rhodes' group because I know a lot of those people. There's lots of ways to make money with hobby farms to kind of help pay for themselves or to help pay you as well. And I know Jessica's done videos about that as well as Justin. So I can't speak to that because we haven't done that. But there's lots of information out there on both of their channels. Do you have to worry about ticks and checking the kids yourselves daily? Yeah, I mean, we do get ticks. I'm hoping again with the chickens and the ducks, they can help keep tick populations down. So I'm hoping that that will help a little bit, but yeah, I mean, we do have to check the kids for ticks, and they know, because we had to do it in our backyard in Charlotte. Like, we lived in a neighborhood and the kids still had to check themselves for ticks and they would get them. So they know where to look. Ticks have certain places they like to hide. Are you planning on studying about gardening or just winging it? I mean, sort of both. I don't like to stunt myself from doing something by focusing too much on making sure that I have it all right completely. But yeah, I mean, like I said, I do tons of reading and watching other videos and research and books and stuff like that to get an idea before I just jump into something. Do the kids play with other kids, or is there too much to do at the farm to go and do other stuff? No, they do. We go to the local park very frequently, and Sierra and I were just commenting the other day on how funny it is that our older girls, when they were younger, they were so shy, and we would go to the parks and playgrounds and stuff like that, and they would just kind of cling to my leg. And our kids now, like especially our younger ones and stuff, are just no fear. We go to the playground and within 10 seconds, Jonah is riding some other kid's back like a bronco and running off playing. The twins are off making friends and playing. Rosie's off making friends. I mean, they all just go to the park and make friends and play and have fun. So that's been our main source of you know, them playing with other kids right now. Our friends who visit, again, I rarely, if ever, vlog when friends come to visit. We just had friends come stay with us for the weekend, and the kids played all weekend long and had a fantastic time. Again, I think this goes back to the idea that a lot of times people think that, and this is not directed at the person asking the question at all, is that because they don't see something, that it's not happening. And of course, the sarcastic answer to that is always like, well, I take a poop and I don't show it, so why would you assume it's not happening if you don't see me poop? Sierra and I, brown chicken, brown cow, and we don't film it. Do you assume that we're not doing that because we don't film it? But I also understand that sometimes when you're just looking at something in passing, it can seem like, well, wait a minute, do they ever do this or that or whatever? So yeah, our kids play with other kids. They get out, they meet other kids, they see other kids. And they're all starting some other activities and doing some other things as well, where they will be making new friends and doing all that kind of stuff. So yes, they get lots of other kiddo interaction. With all the work, how do you handle a sick day of CR or yourself? Luckily, we haven't really had any sick days where either one of us was just completely down and out. We've had days where we don't feel good, but I mean, you really have to just push through. There's no, I don't feel good today, I don't feel like it today. Someone else asked, like, what do you do if you just feel like laying in or sleeping in and not getting up? I don't. You just don't. And this is something that we teach the kids too with having the animals, is like, our responsibility is to take care of them. We've chosen to bring them here. We've chosen to enclose them in this space. And they rely on us 100% for all of their needs, for their food, for their water, for their safety. And that's not a responsibility we take lightly. And so our job is to get up in the morning and take care of them, because they rely on us to do that. And so, yeah, I mean, it's just, we just don't sleep in. We just don't, you know what I mean? We have to get up and take care of them. Things become very habitual the more that you do them. And so after months now of doing this, it's just an extension of what we're used to doing on the daily. So it doesn't seem like, oh geez, I gotta go do this. Like, it's just what we do, you know? So it's just important to me that my kids understand and see it as, you know, you're not going to sit down and enjoy that heaping stack of pancakes and bacon for breakfast while the animals are out there waiting to be fed. Like, we get up, I have my coffee, I start cleaning here, the girls get up, they go outside, they start feeding, the other kids will go out and help, they'll feed dogs, do all of that before we are sitting down to a hot breakfast ourselves, you know? I mean, I get a little coffee in me, but I think that's a favor to everyone. Lots of questions about Lottie, how it came to be that she's out with us. Because she can jump. Like, she can jump. I feel like she would do quite well in the NBA. If there was a goat NBA, she would do well. The goat can jump. It's insane. And yeah, so that's the only reason she's out with us all the time, is because she lets herself out. Why do you call the animals critters? I've never heard that word before. I don't think that critters is a super odd word. I don't know. It just happened and I do. It's funny the things, and again, this is not directed at you personally, but the things that people hone in on and then get annoyed by, and then that's all they hear or notice or whatever. I just call them critters because animals feels too impersonal. Pets feels not the right word. And so I don't know, it's just critters. It's just what I say. And I don't always say it in reference to them, but just depending, I sometimes do. So yeah. Is the aim to have visitors to your farm eventually? Not like open to the public visitors. We've had some questions about that. Do we ever plan to, you know, to have people come here and open? No, nothing like that. I talked about this a little bit on Instagram very briefly. And so I'll just briefly touch on it here because I would like to flesh it out more before I like put it out there. But yeah, my vision would be, and my hope and my big dream would be that someday we would be able to have children from foster care through the foster care system who have come from trauma and traumatic situations be able to come out here and spend time with the animals as part of a therapy. So not necessarily like therapeutic horseback riding. We have a few great facilities for that here in the area, but more just coming out and spending some time in the barnyard, sitting down, petting goats, loving on llamas, scratching pig bellies, and the therapy that those animals provide, just being out there with them, has been so beneficial for a few of our kids and, you know, for myself even and stuff. So I know how beneficial animal therapies can be for people. And there's lots of great programs out there and lots of people do stuff with veterans or old folks homes. And, you know, I'm never opposed to any of those things, but my heart and my vision is more towards, doing something like that for children from trauma, foster care system, that sort of thing. So that would be my long-term sort of hope and dream for that. Do you hope you'll pass the farm down through the family? Yes, I do. I hope that one of my kids will love this place and love these animals enough to want to devote their life to taking care of it and taking care of the animals, because it's not something that you just passively like, oh, I think I'll just, you know, sure, you know, blasé faire, like hang, like you have to really want that. So I hope that one of them will. Do any of your kids not like the animals? No need specifics on which child. I wouldn't say not like. Ivy is a little more afraid of some of them. I think simply just because, you know, they can knock her over, they can whatever. So she's a little more timid, but not afraid. Nobody's really afraid of any of the animals. No, not really. No, she doesn't, like, she sees Aslan running towards her, she'll like, you know, because she doesn't want to get knocked over. Do the dogs all get along? Yes, for the most part. It's actually hilarious to watch Ollie, Shelby's little black and white dog, attack Aslan, and Aslan just lays there and takes it, like, lets Ollie bite all over his face and stuff. It's so cute. Initially, you know, it's just like when you add a new baby to the family, you might have an older sibling that's like, ah, baby. And you might have an older sibling that's a little bit jealous and needs to kind of work through that or whatever, depending on the age of the child. And so with dogs, it's the same as well. You're bringing a new dog into the pack. And so there was definitely a period of adjustment, particularly with Stella and Aslan, because Azzy wanted to play and he just saw Stella as like, oh, you're another dog, play with me, please. And Stella was like, get away from me. I don't want to fool with you, because she's an old lady. But she got used to him and she'd play with him sometimes and she'll put him in his place when she's done playing with him. Chloe likes to play with him and then she finds a place to hide so he can't get her. But ever since, I'm telling you, ever since we switched her to that dog food and she's been doing so much better, I have seen her so many times out in the yard chasing, running, and playing with Aslan. So they all get along. We don't have to keep anybody separated. Somebody's going to hurt somebody else or anything like that. The biggest issue, danger, thing we have to watch for is just that the goats will get into the horse pastures. And some of the horses don't give a rip, and some of them are curious / let me see what would happen if I try to like run down and chase this goat out of here. So sometimes the horses will chase after the goats a little bit if they try to sneak in, but there's no like super malicious trying to kill each other type of behavior between any of the animals. It doesn't mean I would house them together, but I don't worry either. Why do chickens grow so fast? Judith, I don't know. It's hilarious. I knew that they did. So it's hilarious to me to see how these cute little tiny chicks, like in 2 weeks, man, they were like fugly little chicks. I mean, chickens. I think that they're always cute, right? A mother's love. But yeah, it's crazy how quick they go from these little fluff, which is why I think it's insane that people go to like Tractor Supply and buy chickens and ducks as like Easter presents. And like, that's like a 1 week Easter present. Like, what are you gonna do with it? The ducks even, it's insane to see how fast they've grown. The runner ducks especially, like now it takes me a long time to fill up their tub in the morning because I have to put enough water in there that the runner ducks can actually float, because otherwise they just walk on the bottom. They're like, there's not enough water in here, lady. So it's just, it's crazy how fast they grow. Are you sore from all the building? Because I am. Yeah, I constantly have aches and pains and soreness. I take a lot of baths, you know, soaking my back and shoulders. And, you know, Christopher and I are kind of constantly sore in some area or another. But yeah, I mean, if it really, like after the garden and everything and getting the chicken coop, like we were both sunburnt and sore. So we took a couple days off from any like big manual labor projects because we were both just like whooped, you know? The good thing is that we all wear ourselves out here. Christopher and I and the kids. I mean, we often take walks in the evening right at sunset, like right when it's about to be dark. We'll go for the walk all the way around the property and the kids just run. We try to wear them out and they all sleep pretty hard because they just get worn out during the day. What positive impacts has farm life had on the kids? So many, too many to name. I think the responsibility is so good for them. I think the reality that it pulls into their life, the way that they are learning skills that many kids today won't ever learn or know, you know, and even people from my generation as well. I mean, I remember kids going off to college and not knowing how to do a load of laundry or something, which that has nothing to do with farm life, but I love watching my dad here doing something and he's teaching my boys about it, what he's doing. You know, my dad knows so many things that I don't know, Christopher doesn't know, you know, that were taught to him by his dad or his grandpa specifically. His grandfather was a huge influence on him and taught him so many things. And so he's passing that knowledge down to us and down to our kids. And it's just, it's really amazing, you know, like I said, even in reference to homeschooling, I don't remember if that was this video or the last one, but all the very practical applications of these subjects in school and what they look like in real life, actually walking those out and using those skills. It's really fun to watch. And I think the responsibility is so good for them. The selflessness that it takes to, like I said, put feeding the animals before feeding yourself, to understand that if you've chosen to take on, for my older daughters, for example, you know, their bunnies and the dogs and the pigs and all of that, like that you can't just up and go and leave and do, like you have to make arrangements, you have to figure things out. You have to, like, this animal relies solely on you. And I think that that's been really good. And I'm excited to see what we learn as a family and what we all take away from gardening and growing our food and you know, as much as we can. Obviously it's a very simple garden this year, but like as we build on, my camera is like dying on me. It's, and my voice is actually starting to hurt because I've been talking for so long, but there's just so many good questions and I want to get to all of them. This isn't a question. Somebody said, I hope you don't get offended by us asking about your animals. I'm fairly certain that's supposed to be a jab, but I never get offended. What annoys me, and I think would annoy anyone, is assumptions. There's a difference between asking a question and making an assumption about something and inserting it into your question. Having a question that you already have a preconceived notion of what the answer is going to be. Yeah, I don't mind asking questions about animals. But when you ask assuming you already know the answer, or with what's very obviously ill intentions of trying to be like, well, what about this and what about that? There's a big difference, and I'm not a moron and neither are you. So I think we both can understand the difference between the two. So there's lots of questions too about like a farm tour, an in-depth farm tour, more detailed farm tour. So that's going to be coming. I think I've been hesitant because I'm the kind of person like wants everything to be perfect and done before I do that. But I think it's kind of neat to show things in stages. So we did the initial tour of the place when we first bought it. And I think we've been here for 7 months. I was planning to do a 6 month, but we'll do 7 month and call it good. Update and showing where things are at, what we've added, what things have changed around here, and just kind of show the setup. Lots of questions about like a full like drone footage or a full view of the property. I don't know how comfortable I am with that. I don't know. I'll see what we're comfortable with in terms of that. But yes, there's going to be a like full farm tour, meet the animals video, all of that kind of stuff will be coming in the next few weeks to help kind of round it all out and bring things together. There's so many more questions. I wish I could get through more. I feel like two videos that are like an hour a piece is enough of me talking about this stuff for now. So maybe next month or something, I'll do more. But that's it for today's video. Don't forget to go follow me on Instagram or follow our farm account as well. That's all linked down below. And I will see you guys again very soon.